Hi, this is Lynn from Bad Cop, Bad Cop, and you're listening to The New Scene.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to The New Scene. This is Keith.
And Tommy.
And we're back with another new episode. And on tonight's show, Serena Cherry of Svalbard. We have spoken to her. It's an excellent conversation. It's an excellent band. You're going to love it.
I think my favorite thing about the interview is that she is really, really open and honest about just her struggles with things. And one of the things that really kind of resonated with me is she talked about being a woman and being on stage. And the criticism that you receive for being a woman on stage that men don't receive at all. And I constantly think about that now when I'm raising my girls, of instilling that confidence of like, don't give a fuck what other people say, because people are going to say nasty shit no matter what.
Yeah, that part really stuck with me. Also, that we have so many similarities, Serena and I, and you're going to hear about that. It's an excellent conversation. So strap in. That's coming up soon. And folks, as a reminder, follow us on every platform. Facebook, The New Scene. YouTube, The New Scene. Instagram and Twitter, New Scene Pod. We're on the push to 3,500 followers on Instagram. We're getting close. We need you to help us. And of course, twitch.tv/The New Scene. I occasionally go on there and play video games. Check it out if you're into that. And support our sponsor, Iodine Recordings. Here's a couple Iodine updates for you. Iodine has announced, Tommy, are you ready for this?
Let's go.
Iodine has announced a new partnership with Death Wish Inc.
Ooh. You.
Death Wish will be the new exclusive distributor for Iodine and will be hosting the new Iodine web store, which will feature all new merch, including, ready? Including The New Scene shirts. Oh, that's right, folks. You heard it here first. We have shirts, and they're coming, so stay tuned. How about that, Tommy?
I really like the designs on them. You sent me some of the mock-ups today, and I was like, wow. And then you were like, well, we're going to make this one change. And I was like, I like that even better.
Yes.
They're going to look awesome.
Yes. Hang in there, folks. They're coming. Some more Iodine updates. Pre-orders are up for both Audio Karate and Ritual Earth. Go and pre-order those records. They're going to be bangers. Audio Karate's Ultra LP features rare and unreleased material produced by Bill Stevenson of The Descendants and Trevor Keith of Face to Face. And Ritual Earth's debut LP, MMXX, is also available. Ritual Earth are Philadelphia's new doom metal outfit featuring members of Autumn and Chimp Grinder. Heavy and atmospheric doom metal. Go check it out at iodinerecords.com.
They're brutal. They're really good.
Yeah, they're good. They're good. I'm looking forward to hearing the records. A lot of great stuff coming up. Speaking of great stuff, Tommy, we have heard a new Vain song. Vain has a new single out, The Killing Womb, from their upcoming LP, The World Is Going to Ruin You, which releases on March 4th. Tommy, we were talking about this a little bit earlier. I am anticipating this record more than, I think, anything.
I know a lot of people are very, and we had this conversation off the air, but I think it's willing, I think it's a good reason to bring it on here. I know people are hyped about certain bands and they're like, this is the next new big thing. For me, Vain is the only thing I'm really looking forward to right now. Like they put out a track that has brought the anticipation of what this album is going to be to a fever pitch. Like it's incredible. It's just that there's dive bombs in this song that are like, it changes the atmosphere in like, it's unbelievable. Your ears are going to pop. It's amazing.
There's like a dive bomb into like a drum and bass breakbeat part into a vicious breakdown. I think they're one of, if not the most interesting bands out there right now. They're definitely one of my favorites. I cannot wait for this record. This is going to be my favorite heavy release of the year. It's got to be. You know they haven't released a new LP since 2017, Tommy?
Really?
Yeah, this has been a long time in the making. Now, they did have an LP come out in 2020 where they re-recorded some old songs and did some remixes and all that stuff. And that was great because I hadn't heard some of those songs. I didn't even know that they had those releases on Bandcamp. So it was a great way to catch up. And I like some of the remix stuff that they do. But this is a true new LP coming out on March 4th. And we haven't had that in a long time.
I really can't wait to hear this new stuff. And I like what you said before, they do things that other bands don't do, which is they merge a bunch of different things together. So for example, you have those heavy kind of breakdown parts, but you also have these breakbeat interludes. You have a lot of electronic kind of sounds that go along with it, not just like that glitchy kind of thing that they were kind of, you know, they became known for. But I'm excited because I can already see them kind of pushing the boundaries of what their sound is. And I'm excited to really see what they do with it.
Yeah, I can't wait for the record. It's going to be exciting. There's going to be a lot of great music this year. I can feel it. Can you feel it, Tommy? Are you ready for this?
I don't know if I'm ready for it. I'll be honest with you. There's a lot of times there's a couple bands that have put things out that I was like, oh yeah, I can't wait to hear that. And I hear it and I'm like, I need to sit with this for a moment. Like this is, it's almost too much. But yeah, Vane is one of those bands that, and why Vane FM?
Maybe it was a legal thing.
Was it kind of like, I keep thinking when I see that, I think of that other heavy band, Kublai Khan.
Yeah.
They have to call themselves Kublai Khan TX now because I guess there was another band called Kublai Khan. So whatever. I'm excited for it, but it's also one of those things where I don't want it to be a letdown. And I also
it's
don't.
It's impossible. Did you hear that single?
That single is incredible. However, I have heard records that have an incredible single and the rest is trash.
Well, that will not be the case with Vane. It's physically impossible.
With the amount of creativity coming out of that band, it is completely impossible because they are just, they're all over the place. They are kind of where I think Dillinger kind of left off for me, where it's technical, but at the same time, it's that heavy and kind of almost, I don't want to say artsy because that almost seems like kind of insulting, but it's really innovative. That's the word I'm looking for. They really are. They're doing new things. And I'm really excited to hear what they come up with.
Well, folks, that's it for this segment. Check back in with us at the end. But now we're going to talk to Serena Cherry of Svalbard. Enjoy. All right, folks, we're here now with Serena Cherry. Serena, welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
It's excellent to have you here. We're big fans of Svalbard. And we want to dig into the music, but first we got to know, how are you doing today?
I'm good, thank you. I've had a really fun day. I went to my local theme park for their winter event, and I've been to the gym, so feeling pretty good.
Oh, nice. What's the theme park?
Oh, it's not a very big one. It's called Chessington World of Adventures. And for Christmas, they do like cute wintery stuff. You can bake like festive cookies and they have lots of animal talks and a few rides open for Christmas. So it's cute. It's not like anything like what you have in America, though.
It sounds really nice, though. How were the holidays for you? I have survived the holidays unscathed, which I'm happy about. How did they go for you, Serena?
I mean, I'm not to sound too negative, I'm not a massive fan of the holidays and Christmas. I don't really like not being able to do what I want. So if it was up to me and I had, you know, so at the moment I've got 4 days off work, I would love to just like play loads of guitar, go to the gym, read my books. But instead I found you have a lot of obligations and things. So I'm always relieved when it's over.
Yes, you sound like me. You know, I'm happy to see family and friends and all that stuff, but I'm really happiest when I'm in my den with all of my toys.
Yes.
So let's see. You grew up in Bristol, England, yes?
Yeah, that's right.
And how was it growing up there? Do you still live there now, don't you?
No, I live in London now.
Oh, nice. So which one do you like better?
London, without a doubt. London just, I mean, there's so much variety. And if you're into things like musicals and like a huge variety of music, like there's always really cool, interesting stuff happening. Bristol is still pretty good, but it's a bit more cliquey. That would be the word I would use to describe Bristol. Like lots of people who are too cool and things like that. And obviously the music scene that Bristol's famous for is trip hop. And I sort of found as a musician growing up there, unless you were doing that thing, that like Portishead, Massive Attack, trip hop sound,
yeah,
people aren't interested. Like that's all they care about in Bristol. There wasn't much of a metal scene. It's definitely got better now over the last, 5 years or so. But I much prefer living in London.
Yeah, that sounds more up my alley. So, Serena, you have one of the, I always ask guests, how they discovered the underground music and their entry point. And I think you have one of the best heavy music discovery intro stories I've ever heard. So please tell that.
Well, I am also into gaming, and I was playing a game called MTV Sports Snowboarding. I guess it's kind of similar to Tony Hawk's in that the soundtrack was kind of iconic and probably converted a lot of people into heavy music. And I was playing this game a lot, and there was a Fear Factory song on the soundtrack. It was Edge Crusher off the Obsolete album. And I remember the first time I ever heard it, I was scared of it. I must have been about 12 years old, and I was like, whoa, that's like the craziest man. Like he must be so upset. He sounds so angry. But when you're that age, you're kind of fascinated by the things that scare you. Like I remember when I'd go into the video rental store and I'd be scared of all the covers of the horror films like Hellraiser, but then I ended up being fascinated by them and watching them all. It was the same kind of thing. I kept listening to that Fear Factory song when I played MTV Sports Snowboarding. And then eventually I had a job doing like a paper, I guess, in America, you call it a paper route.
Yeah.
And I saved my money from that to buy a copy of Obsolete on CD. And Fear Factory was very much my entry point into metal. And then I discovered Slipknot, and I was fully obsessed with Slipknot.
Nice. And I love that you discovered it. That's the first time I've heard that story where someone's entry point was gaming. And I love that because I'm an avid gamer myself. And growing up, I had friends, but I didn't find a lot of acceptance in general from people. So I lost myself in gaming. Plus my school, I got bullied at school because I was into gaming, which I found weird as a 12-year-old kid. Like I'm very resistant. So that just made me like it even more. I'm like, oh, you don't want me to do this? Well, fuck you. I'm into it even more.
Do you know what? I'm exactly the same. And I had exactly the same thing of I was really into gaming and it sort of alienated me. I didn't have many friends at school and I was quite badly bullied. And then, yeah, because of that discourage, it made me even more passionate and it made me even more like, into all the things that I got, taken the piss out of for. So it made me like metal more. It made me like gaming more because those were the things that made me happy.
Yeah, no one was into what I was into, really. I liked the more avant-garde stuff at the time. It was like Marilyn Manson and Korn. These were emerging bands. And if you liked them, you were a weirdo. And I liked that whole angle of it. And then I got adopted by a group of hardcore kids, and those became my best friends for life. So what was your trajectory? Did you find friends? Did you find connection in the things that you enjoyed?
What was the big one for me in terms of finding people where you really click and gel with them it wasn't really music. So with metal, I have friends who also listen to metal, but maybe not the same type of metal. Like they might listen to deathcore and things like that, which isn't really my personal cup of tea. The big thing for me was I'm also a roller coaster enthusiast, and I joined a roller coaster enthusiast forum called Coaster Force, and that's where I met my people, and they are people from all different walks of life, all, but we all have a very similar mentality of like just getting out there, going to as many theme parks and getting on as many rides as we want to. And I've made some of the best friends I've ever had through that website. And that I joined that website when I was about 15, 16 years old. But then in terms of like with metal, I've never really felt that I've had like a group of friends. I've had bandmates. Basically, that has kind of been where my connection with people has been through music, has been through jamming with people and forming like a band connection. But I wouldn't say I've ever had that like group of friends where we, you know, 90% of the time I go to shows on my own or and stuff like that, because I haven't met that many people who like the same music as me. My social side definitely came from being a roller coaster enthusiast.
Well, that's interesting. I love that. And I you know, reading about you, Serena, I see that you've met a lot of people through forums over the years, and me too, you know, because I'm a disciple of the internet. And I have a hard time meeting people. So a lot of the friends I've made have been through music message boards and that type of thing as well.
Oh, absolutely. Like for me, the internet has been so liberating. And so, you know, yeah, if you're a bit introverted and you're a bit shy and you want to talk about the specific niche passions that you have, the internet is where you're going to flourish.
Serena, real quick, what's your dream roller coaster? Like, what's the roller coaster that you want to go on more than anything else?
Superman Escape from Krypton at Six Flags Magic Mountain.
Nice. How old were you when you went on your first roller coaster? Because I think I was afraid to go on them until I was 12. And then when I finally went on one that had a loop, I was like, oh my God, I got it out of the way. I'm good.
I think my first big roller coaster was Nemesis at Alton Towers when I was 10 years old. That roller is a suspended coaster, kind of like the Batman ones that you get in the US.
Oh, yeah.
And it had like loops and everything. And I remember just being fascinated by it because it has quite a dark theme to it. So what always drawed me in with the roller coasters from a really young age was like the imaginative story and the theming. And this one had like fake rivers of blood and like demons and like bones and stuff everywhere. And I was just, I think I've always been a bit drawn into that sort of darker side of things. It amazed me that the way this whole thing came together, like the music, the imagery, and then the fact that you could actually get on board and ride it and experience it and feel the forces. Like I always say, roller coasters to me, they're 3D art. You know, you look at it, you see it, and then you experience it. But so, yeah, it was Nemesis Alton Towers when I was 10. And I think one mistake that's kind of often perceived about roller coaster enthusiasts is that, you know, we don't get scared or phased by any rides, and that's not true. I think you wouldn't ride them if you didn't get that thrill, if you didn't get that little nerve, you know, when you're 200 foot in the air. That's part of it, is kind of looking at something that looks quite scary and being able to conquer it.
Yeah, I would think as an enthusiast you would seek out the next thrill and want to conquer it.
Exactly. Always the next thrill. That's what I'm seeking.
So what is the scariest roller coaster you've been on?
Oh, that's a good question. This is quite niche. There's a theme park in Germany called Hansa Park, really far up north in Germany. And everything's themed really like gothic towers and ghosts. And it's amazing. It's as if Cradle of Filth made a roller coaster. But they have one there which is very tall. It's about 239 foot, if I'm not mistaken. And it takes you up vertically. So you're fully like, you know, kind of on your back as you're going up. And then it stops at the top. And instead of going over, it drops you back down the lift that you just came up. and then takes you back up, and then you do like a massive roller coaster afterwards. But that ride is very dramatic, and I've ridden it, I mean, several times, and every time I still get freaked out when it starts to, you know, drop, fall backwards.
That sounds amazing. So how did you decide you wanted to start playing music? Did you see live bands and get inspired by it, or was it something else?
I was really, really obsessed with Joey Jordison in particular from Slipknot. And as soon as I bought the self-titled album, I was so amazed by the drumming. I would have been about, 12 years old. And I just said, right, that's what I want to do. I want to learn to play drums in the same way that he does. And so I begged my parents for so long to let me have drum lessons. And I actually started on drums. I can play drums as well. I just happen to not play drums in any bands at the moment. I eventually got my first drum kit and I had some lessons, and I got quite frustrated with the drum teacher because he wanted to teach me snare drum rudiments and all that kind of marching band stuff. And I'm just there the whole time like, I want to learn double kick. Teach me double kick. Eventually, I ended up teaching myself because he wouldn't. It was drums. And that was what I played. That was my main instrument for quite a few years. And then my sister had a 3/4 size classical guitar in her bedroom. And I just started, you know what it's like, you get into one instrument and then you're like hungry for more. You're like, what else can I do? So I would sneak into her room when she was out and like try and figure out Slayer riffs on this classical guitar.
Nice.
And that was, that was my journey to music. I've never had a guitar lesson. I'm completely self-taught. I hold a pick completely wrong. And I don't know the names of most of the chords or anything. Not the most technical guitarist in the world, but I found like as much as I love drumming and I love drumming in bands and like jamming with people, it was guitar where I really felt I could express myself.
Well, whatever it is you're doing, please keep doing it because your music sounds amazing. So whatever you're doing, it's the right thing.
Oh, thank you.
Yes. So how did you start playing in bands? How did you find people? What was some of your early work?
I think the natural progression for anyone who's obsessed with bands like Slipknot and things where there's kind of like a real dark imagery going on, I then discovered black metal when I was about 15, 16 years old, and I bought a 4-track and I actually made a couple of black metal albums in my bedroom using a really bad, awful drum machine that would just play the same loop over and over again and writing guitar parts over it. And I made a couple of demo tapes and then asked people if they would like play them live with me. And I met, a few people who wanted to play the stuff live. And that was my first band. Our first ever show was actually supporting the Japanese black metal band Galhammer. So I think we really lucked out there. We managed to play some really cool shows. And that was my first ever live band. I mean, it was a weird one because kind of like all black metal bands, I wrote all the music and I was, it wasn't like we all got in a room and jammed. No one else really contributed any ideas. So it didn't give me that full taste of a band dynamic. And then I find once you do one band and you play one show, it's like that validation. People kind of acknowledge you as a musician and then you'll slowly start to meet other people and join other things. And then after that, after that, I joined a prog band. I actually played in a prog band for years. We had 3 guitarists and no vocalist. That's how prog we were. And that was where I really improved my guitar playing because the two other guitarists in that band, the two best guitarists I've ever played music with, don't tell Liam that. And they pushed me so far out of my comfort zone, like the stuff they'd be writing. And I was like, wow, I've got to try and keep up. And that was super fun. But I think we were a bit, as a band, we were a bit of a hard sell because we were strange instrumental prog and we were quite heavy. So we didn't really fit on like more kind of rock shows, but we were also too weird to play metal shows. So it unfortunately didn't really go anywhere. But that was how I met Svalbard, is they saw me playing in that band and were like, ah, oh, do you want to do that, you know, what you play on guitar, but heavier? Like, yes.
Serena, what were the first black metal bands that really kind of grabbed your attention?
Satyricon, I really liked. I was a big fan of Rebel Extravaganza when they kind of went a bit strange. Songs like Filth Grinder, where the time signature keeps kind of rolling in these weird places. That really grabbed me. Emperor, but strangely, Equilibrium 9, which no one else seems to think is the best Emperor album. I was obsessed. Equilibrium 9, I had that on tape. Really, really loved that record. I still do, to be fair. And Immortal, At the Heart of Winter. That was a big one for me. And then I got into the more kind of US, I think at the time it was called like suicidal black metal. So bands like Zaster and Leviathan and all that kind of really hypnotic, drony, dark. Forgotten Tomb, that was another band from that sort of sound that I got into as well. Oh, but my favorite now, I wouldn't even say they're probably not described as black metal, but Keep of Callison, my favorite of the, I guess you could call them black metal bands.
I like the Equilibrium 9 too. I think Anthems to Welcome at Dusk is, that's my go-to. Anthems is the at least in my opinion, far superior. However, I'll have to revisit Equilibrium again because I haven't listened to it in probably about 5 or 6 years.
Anthems is my second favorite, and I totally understand why it is people's favorites, because it just has everything, doesn't it? But I think Equilibrium 9, because it's weirder and it's goes in on little tangents, I think that's what keeps me hooked.
I was going to say they go a little bit more symphonic in that one than I had originally. Like, I always thought of Emperor as like, you know, just straightforward black metal, and then I remember hearing Equilibrium and I was like, oh, okay, a lot of keyboards here. I think that kind of drew me in the opposite direction, but I'll have to revisit it. I appreciate that.
Okay, so Serena, Svalbard sees you at a gig and they recruit you. So they had already been a band at this point?
No, so I worded that a bit strange. It was Liam from Svalbard was how it happened. He was tour driving the headline band of a show that my band supported. Mm-hmm. And he turned up in a Dying Fetus shirt and I was like, hey, cool shirt. And he watched my prog band and then said to me afterwards, just him, oh, I'd like to do, because he saw me doing the kind of the tremolo stuff in that band and was like, I'd like to do something like that, but heavier and with these other influences. And I was like, cool. So just me and Liam, we started the band. We just started riffing, writing, trading ideas, kind of just on guitar between ourselves. And then we were in the rehearsal place where Liam used to work, just coming up with riffs, and this other band were playing, and we heard this like phenomenal drummer in the other room, and we're there. And at the time, I think he was playing in like a thrash kind of thrash death metal band. We heard him playing and we're like, wow, this guy's great. So he came out of the room that he was rehearsing in and we poached him. We were like, come and play with us instead. And that was how we got Mark in the band. And that's been like, we've kind of had the core three of us ever since. And that's how Svalbard was formed. It wasn't so much that they were already a band and they got me in. We sort of built up the idea together. And then we've had exactly 1 million and two different bassists.
I have found that bass is the hardest instrument to fill because the person either tries to do too much all the time or you just can't find anybody.
Exactly. Yeah, that is the issue. The thing we've found is they always get girlfriends. So they join the band and they're like, yes, this is fun. I'm having a great time. They get a girlfriend, they leave. That's been the pattern for about 5 years.
I find it interesting that you actually poached your drummer from an adjacent practice room, because that happens to me a lot where I'm practicing with a band and we hear someone in the other room and we're like, who are they? Who's that? And you did that. You heard the guy and you actually got him.
I know. How lucky are we?
That's pretty rare. That's awesome. So you guys meet, you're jamming, you're playing now. Who were your influences early on? Because I love the music. It combines the best of everything. You've got hardcore, metal, black metal, post-rock, which I'm obsessed with. Who were some of your influences early on?
At the time, well, this is what's, I think, interesting and what helped kind of carve our sound is that the three of us, Mark, Liam and I, come from such different musical inspiration points. So it's like this melting pot of all different kind of influence and inspiration. Me personally, at the time, I was really influenced by post-rock, like Mono, Explosions in the Sky, Dirty Three, also like those really kind of beautiful, atmospheric, tremolo, soundscapey stuff that builds and builds and builds. And that's what I was basing my lead lines on, was that same kind of majesty that you get in a Mono song. And then Liam is really into bands like kind of Human Remains and kind of the more grindy stuff, bands like Nasum and things like that, and more hardcore-y side of things. And then Mark is just into sort of like a lot of, it's weird because I think this is the thing, the bands that influence Svalbard aren't necessarily the bands that we sound like. So like Mark is really into his death metal, really loves like Cattle Decapitation and that kind of thing. But you, to listen to him as a drummer, you would think he was more influenced by like D-beat and punk and hardcore. But it was just kind of the way things fell together in the room as we jammed. It was like a meeting point in the middle for all of us. But we don't necessarily sound like what influences us, if you know what I mean.
Absolutely. I find that the most interesting bands come from the type of background that you just described. Because my thing used to be like, hey, this band is good, let's sound exactly like them. But I've realized that's not really the approach. The more different types of music you're listening to and the more different influences that you're putting into the music, I think the more interesting results you'll have.
Oh, definitely. I mean, it's the same with anything. If you eat the same food every day, you're going to get bored of it. And if you just listen to one type of music or one type of metal, you're just restricting what you consume so much, and you're never going to be open to inspiration from other places. So like, I think I'm always really proud of like how diverse the influences of Svalbard are. I think it's a good thing.
100%. So how was it early on? Did you find acceptance? Were you able to book shows? Was it difficult? Set the stage for us a little bit.
Well, Liam used to be in the, probably, I guess, deathcore would be the description for them. Deathcore band Burning Skies, who they did all right. They were quite popular in the UK and the mainland. So when people saw that Liam from Burning Skies was doing a new project, we did get booked for shows and things. But then I think people were expecting it to be more like what he used to do than what he did now. So I wouldn't say, like, especially in Bristol, like with what I said before, where unless you're playing the thing that's fashionable in Bristol, people don't really come to your show or don't really show you much support. It definitely took a bit of time for it to get off the ground. Like, we were okay with getting initial gigs, like getting a good support slot or getting, you know, a good local show here and there, because people trusted, they were excited that it was Liam's new project kind of thing. But in terms of like people showing an interest in what we were doing and what we were playing, it was, it definitely took a good while to kind of build up any sort of a following, really. What was interesting is we went over to Europe quite early on and we got way better reception there and got treated way better there, even when we'd only been a band for like a year or so. So I always definitely felt that the mainland appreciated us way before the UK did.
That always seems to be the way that it goes. Europeans must just have, they just must have better taste, because things just seem to be better over there in terms of musicians and more cutting edge in terms of what they're listening to.
Definitely. And I think the attitude there is completely different as well. Like, people will just come out to a gig to bands they've never heard of just to check it out. Like, there's a hunger that you see in countries like Germany that just isn't really there in the UK, and an appreciation. And they'll come, they'll check you out, even if they've never heard of you. And if they like it, they will, like, you know, support you and buy a record and everything. And it's just, yeah, like, definitely a lot more kind of proactive, I'd say, when it comes to underground music in the mainland.
So how did things start to pick up for Svalbard? When did you notice a change in people becoming more receptive to the band?
There were certain turning points, and there were certain, you know, when you all, sometimes all it takes is to play one good festival slot, and then you've gained like a whole new following really, really quickly in one show. We played a festival that sadly doesn't exist anymore called Temples Festival, which was kind of like, I would describe it as like the equivalent of Inferno Festival in Norway, but in the UK. And we managed to play that quite early on. And we just seemed to, the room was full for starters, which was crazy considering we were on like super early. And people just seemed really super receptive, and like, we just watched the following like double so quickly after like that. And then as soon as you do a show like that and you've got your name on the poster of a festival with that kind of accolade, it was so much easier getting better support slots and getting on other better festivals. So there's definitely been like a few turning points that I can pinpoint. One was playing Temples Festival. The second was playing Arctangent Festival, which is a independent festival here in the UK that's grown quite big now. And again, it was just falling on the right ears at the right time. People, a super receptive crowd. And then that again, that just seemed to propel us into better places. But then when we also played Arctangent was when we met who is now our booking agent and manager, and he missed Godspeed You Black Emperor to come and check us out, which is crazy.
Wow.
And then after, I know, right? That's like a vote of confidence. Afterwards, he was like, yeah, okay, I want to work with you guys. And then obviously, as soon as you have people helping you out who've got the experience and they've got the rosters to get you great support slots, great festival slots, then that's when you really notice things starting to pick up.
So how old were you when all this was occurring?
Oh, well, I'm 33 now, and Svalbard's been a band for 11 years. So it probably would have been like mid-20s, 25, 26, maybe, when it started to, you know, seem like more than a hobby, which was, I mean, still blows my mind to this day.
Right. Like, you're in your mid-20s. I assume you're gigging all over the place. Did you think, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life? Did you have anything else in mind?
Oh my God, no. This was absolutely the thing I live for. It always will be. Like, yeah, it was just a joy to me to be able to finally be out there playing as much as possible, playing in all these new places, watching like the reactions of the crowd. Like, I loved it. I mean, I love my favorite thing is band practice. It's like, that's the best thing I think you can do with your time, is be in a room with three of your friends playing your instruments super loud. Like, wow, I'll never get bored of that. And just being able to do that regularly, play shows regularly, like, it's still the dream. I still have to pinch myself. I love it. And like, my passion will never die for that, I don't think.
That's a beautiful thing. So how do you survive while you're touring with the band? Like, what kind of jobs did you have to work?
I mean, I've worked lots of jobs that I haven't really liked. So lots of, I don't know if you have them in the States, but like 0 hours contracts where you're not contracted to fulfill any hours. And then they put you in for like crazy hours 1 week and then no hours the next week. So I had a lot of that kind of work, a lot of retail work. At the moment, I work doing the social media for a big company, and it's really stressful and target driven. And that's the kind of, I think for me, it's the trade-off of I get to play shows and be in a band and do all this cool stuff And then the downside is that I end up having to take kind of jobs that are not fulfilling, that are not, don't treat you very well, just to tide me over, because as everyone will tell you, it's very, very hard to make a consistent living from music at the moment. So there needs to be something else so that I can pay the rent.
So I'm guessing you and the band have been affected by COVID and the lockdowns, and are things open or things aren't? It changes week to week.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think COVID and the lockdowns really took the wind and the momentum out of us as a band, and we found it quite hard to get back into the rhythm. I mean, even things like, at the moment, we don't know if we can book rehearsals because we don't know if the rules are going to change next week. We've got a tour booked with Cult of Luna in February and March. And, you know, I'm just hoping that it goes ahead. But it's that tricky situation of, at the moment, of not really being able to plan. And I think everyone, even if you're not in a band, is in that similar situation where you can't look more than 24 hours beyond your life at the moment, because things could all change again. And I think as a band, we found lockdown really frustrating. We released an album during the pandemic, which I think was a blessing in the long run, because people were in lockdown and they had more time to sit there and listen to an album and consume it. So I think that was a good thing. And we finally got to do a little tour last month in the UK and play those songs live over a year after we released them. But, you know, I think the reaction was as good as it was because people have really had the time to like listen to a lot more music than, and listen to it and give it their full time and focus rather than, you know, being on a train and kind of listening to things in passing. So I think there's is like pros and cons of how the pandemic has affected us as a band. But at the moment, we're in a bit of a tough situation where it's really, really hard to plan. And yeah, it's like we've had to take jobs elsewhere to be able to pay the rent. And it's a lot of pressure.
Yeah, the pandemic changed things forever for me and so many people. I remember when it first started, well, one of my coping mechanisms, which I think you'll appreciate, has been video games. I've thrown myself into them. When the pandemic first started, I watched like a 15-hour YouTube video of Final Fantasy VII that someone put together, just like all the cutscenes. So that's what I would watch for comfort. I got heavily into gaming and yeah, I just kind of threw myself into that and YouTube to pass the time. How did you cope?
I wrote a solo album. That's how I coped. I mean, initially, I still sort of feel like there's definitely lasting mental damage. Like there's definitely been an impact on my mental health from lockdown and the pandemic. But my way of coping, especially initially, you just didn't expect it. You didn't expect to have a year's worth of shows cancelled just like that. And everything you'd planned, everywhere you were planning to go, just taken away from you. Like it was really hard. And at the time I lost my previous job at the start of the pandemic because I was working in retail, and like I say, it was a 0 hours contract, so they had no obligation to pay the staff money when we couldn't work, so we all just lost our jobs in that place. So I lost my job and I lost all the Svalbard shows and everything, and I felt really lost. And I threw myself, I figured out how to use Logic and wrote a black metal album themed to Skyrim. And that was basically all I did for months, was play Skyrim and write an album about Skyrim. And I genuinely, I think Elder Scrolls got me through the pandemic, to be honest with you.
You're speaking my language. And the band, of course, is Noctul, right?
Yes.
Yes, Noctul, a band based on Skyrim. This sounds right up my alley. Now, I haven't played Skyrim, but I want to because it just sounds legendary.
Oh, it is. I know everyone says this, but it really is one of the best games of all time. That and Final Fantasy VII. But Skyrim is just, it's, I think what's so great about it is the level of immersion and the just how you get so drawn into the world and the storylines and the characters. Like, oh my God, it's really, I don't think I'll ever get bored of playing it.
You know what I started playing again in 2019? EverQuest. Did you ever play that?
Oh, Oh God, not for a long time, but I have played it before.
It's still around. Now, folks, if you're not familiar, that's like the precursor to World of Warcraft, like true nerd shit. Online RPG, different worlds, different classes, the whole shebang.
I was listening to the World of Warcraft soundtrack the other day.
We sound very similar, and I like that. So yeah. I did a lot of research about you, Serena, and you know, I read that you went through a lot of tough experiences in 2019 and 2020, and that a lot of that experience ended up in the lyrical content for Svalbard in your latest album, When I Die, Will I Get Better? And, you know, I was inspired because someone who's dealt with depression, addiction, you know, falling to the very bottom and having to crawl my way all the way back up, I was very inspired by your story. Can you share some of your experiences with us and what you did to overcome them?
Yeah. So 2019, I can always mark it as one of the worst years of my life. And I was really struggling with my mental health. I think that's the thing, is like I'd always kind of had the black cloud there. It was always lurking. But that year, it really just eclipsed everything else in my life. And I felt kind of paralyzed by my mental health and depression and anxiety. And it was just spiraling out of control. I felt like a shell of myself. And I think when you're really struggling with your mental health, it causes such a dip in your self-esteem, and just started sort of just doing things that weren't good for me, that were kind of harmful to me. And spiraling and sort of struggling to really climb back out of that and things. And the lyrics of When I Die, Will I Get Better, all those songs are about specific things that I went through. And I kind of look at it now and I go, well, that's, you know, I don't think you don't have to have something good come from everything, but being able to look at, say, you know, the pain that I went through in that abusive relationship, and then have a song like Open Wound, which is about that. It's like a chrysalis moment for me, where you took all the kind of pain and turned it into a song, and it's kind of turned something from something really, really negative and damaging into something that maybe can help others with its resonance. And like the whole idea with When I Die, Will I Get Better was, I was so desperate and so low when we wrote that album. In the back of my head, I was like, I don't want anyone else to feel like this. And if they do, I want that power of that resonance of, I wanted to make a record that made people feel less alone when they were struggling, and made people feel kind of like there was someone there who understood how difficult things can be when your mental health isn't in a good place.
Yeah, I think that's a beautiful thing, that you can use the art to pull yourself out and turn things around and use it as something to help other people, because it's so hard when you're in that state. And I understand, because this year was kind of that year for me. I went through some stuff and felt really abandoned by people, and it just brought out all the worst qualities in me, and I had to kind of overcome all of that. But when you're in that state and you can't eat and you can't sleep and your stomach feels sick all the time and you feel like it's never going to get better and you feel like no one's going to care, you just have to slog through it day by day until it gets better, which it does eventually. And, you know, maybe something good comes of it and maybe not, but I think we're always stronger having survived those moments.
Definitely. Absolutely. And yeah, like you learn to trust yourself a bit more, because you can reflect and go, I got through that. You know what I mean? I lived through those days where I couldn't eat or sleep or, yeah, any of those things. And I felt like I was falling apart. And I remember at the time people saying to me, oh, things will get better. And you don't believe them when they say that, because it's so hard to conceive that things will get better. Because the only way I can describe, like, with depression, is that it prevents you from being able to feel happiness. It's not that, you know, you can't be bothered to pursue anything or anything like that, which I think is a common misconception. It's like, you could be, I remember being like, at a theme park with my friends doing the thing I should love and having to keep going to the toilets because I kept breaking down crying because all I could feel was, yeah, this horrible sense of like bleakness and dread. And it's like the seesaw is so imbalanced. You have all the negative, but none of the positive just isn't there. It just doesn't come. But then to look back on that now, I feel so much stronger because I'm like, I survived that. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. How did you notice that you were starting to come out of it? Like for me, I would say things manifested for me to a point where I didn't trust anybody and I was kind of like sinking into hatred. And I was like, I'm going to let everybody know how I feel. I don't like this person. I don't like that person. I'm going to get revenge. You know, there's just all this mental gymnastics over nothing, really. And once I let all of that go and decided to just try to get along with everybody and just have things be cool, it was like a weight was lifted off of me and I could finally function again like the person that I am. How did it occur in your life? When did you start to think like, oh, like things are looking up?
It was a really, really slow process for me. And it wasn't, I think this is the problem is when you're really low, you want to wake up and have a day where everything has changed drastically and suddenly you're feeling great and all that sadness is a thing of the past. And that isn't how you get out of a spell of depression. It's like so slow and so many little changes. A big one for me was going back to the gym because I think subconsciously that was me going, I care about myself enough to do something physical to just get. And at the time I just viewed it as, well, if I exercise, that will force my body to release some kind of endorphins. And I was really sort of trying to listen to how I felt, like I'd feel horrendous, mind spinning, all of this before the gym. And then after the gym, I'd feel like, you know, 10% calmer. I wasn't like walking on air because you don't when you're really struggling with your mental health. But I'd be like, oh, that's a small change for the better. And I just noticed like, I kind of had to remind myself to do those things like go to the gym, to take care of myself and kind of be kinder to myself and give myself an opportunity to, yeah, release some endorphins. Or at least I always, you know, I think that was a nice thing for me. If I got out and went to the gym, I'd be like, right, I have done something today. Do you know what I mean? I've left my bed. I haven't. And then you sort of, the more you have that sense of kind of overcoming it, the more you chase that. so that was definitely, little steps like going to the gym. I joined a jiu-jitsu class and that was kind of good because it forced me to interact with new people and stuff like that. And yeah, and just like getting out of a bad relationship and all those things, it just, and being okay with being on your own, all that kind of stuff slowly got me back up to a much better place.
Yeah, that's the thing, is it takes time and it takes help outside of ourselves, whatever that is. I find communities and groups of people and talking to others and talking to friends and activities like you described are the answer.
Definitely. Something that really helped me was talking to other people who have struggled. So I remember having conversations with other friends who have really struggled with depression and anxiety, and they would say these little things that you only notice yourself, and then you hear someone else say it and you feel like this relief of, oh, it's not just me. So things like, I remember my friend saying about forgetting to clean her teeth every time when she was really depressed. And I was like, oh, good. It's not just me. I'm not a complete failure who doesn't remember to brush their teeth. Like that is a thing with depression or just general forgetfulness. I remember I used to feel so rude or so bad about myself because I'd like see someone at a show who I'd met before, or I'd be talking about something and then I would just completely forget like who this person was or what I was talking about or anything. It was like my memory was just not functioning at all. And then I heard other people who struggle with depression say the same thing. And that is such a huge relief because you're suddenly like, oh, I'm not alone. It's not just me kind of falling apart and being useless. This is a symptom and other people have reported it. So I'd always say like one of the best things you can do if you're really struggling with your mental health is talk to other people who are as well.
100%. Yeah. And we can't be everything to everybody all the time. Sometimes we're not in the mood to talk to people. Sometimes we might forget somebody's name, and that's all okay.
Yeah, exactly. Don't put pressure on yourself to be, you know, perfect or great all the time. Like, you're human.
In doing research, I saw that When I Die, Will I Get Better? That was supposed to come out on Holy Roar, yes? When that label was still around?
Yeah.
Yeah, now I was surprised. We had that was some label with some roster. There's Svalbard, who I love. There's Respire, who I love. There's Rollo mm-hmm. Tomasi, who I just... And we actually had Respire on the show before, and, you know, they had to find a new label for their record that was coming out. And I think your record ended up moving to Church Road, just like Respire, yes?
Yes.
Yeah, so that must have been another horrible roadblock when the allegations against Alex Fitzpatrick come out and, you know, suddenly the carpet is pulled from underneath you once again.
It was a really tough time, and my heart absolutely went out to those victims, and it was shocking. Like, you know, when you sort of know someone and you have no idea what they're capable of, and then you read these things, and it's just, it makes you question everything. And I just felt so like sick to my stomach that we could be releasing an album on a label with a guy that is capable of hurting people in that way. It was just really, really heartbreaking how that, you know, hearing those allegations made me feel. And there was no question, as soon as we heard it, there was no question that we absolutely would not work with this label again. But we were the next release due to be coming out on that record label, and I think we had 2 weeks to turn it around. So 2 weeks to salvage getting the album off the Holy Roar release and onto the Church Row release. And that's like, I mean, Church Road just did such an amazing job. They worked so many hours, so much stuff and energy they put into being able to make sure that the Svalbard album was still released on time. Like, that's been the kind of, you know, when something really bad happens, but it makes the people who really are great and good in the music industry shine through, and you go, you are great people in this industry, you're like leading lights. And that's how I feel about Church Road now. Like, and they released the Noctual record as well, and they've just been they're people in the music industry who truly love and care about music, which is quite rare. But it was really stressful, a really stressful time, trying to figure out how to still get the album released relatively on time but not have it released on Holy Roar, because as soon as we heard the allegations, we didn't want anything more to do with them.
You've been outspoken on social media. You know, you advocate for women's rights. And I read in a quote from one of your interviews where you said, the more outspoken I've got, the more shit I've got on the internet. Do you still find that to be the case?
Yeah, that's why I'm not outspoken anymore. So my Twitter is lighthearted now, because I can't deal. That was one of the other things, actually, I noticed. So in 2019 was when I was very outspoken about certain things, and very outspoken about my experience as a woman in metal, and, you know, always trying to fight the keyboard warriors in the comments who were making sexist remarks and all the shit that people used to talk about me and stuff like that, and just how degrading people would be about me and my band, and all the comparisons, like, all people want to talk about is how I look like, and I was always trying to fight it. I was being so reactive to all of it, and then I kind of stepped back and I was like, is that helping my mental health? Is, you know, I still dread going onto my social media every day, because I'm like, right, what comment's going to be next, what's going to be next, and stuff like that. And that's not a good feeling. So it was it's sad, but it is a deliberate change for me to kind of, basically, I hold my beliefs and I'll sing about my beliefs in my songs, and I'll sing about my experiences of sexism within metal in my songs, but I am not going to tweet about things. I'm not gonna, you know, things like, we played Bloodstock Festival in the UK this year in August. And we've got the song Clickbait, which is about how women in metal are written about. But I know that Bloodstock is a very mainstream, typical, you know, the people who comment on Metal Injection websites are the kind of people who go to Bloodstock. I knew if I said anything on stage that was remotely political, it was going to alienate most of the crowd and cause people to just come up to me and give me shit. So I was like, right, I'm going to just tone everything down. I've done it to protect myself, because there was one article written about me and other women in metal, and it was written as if women are coming to steal the guys' jobs. It was like, oh, women in metal are challenging the men, and, you know, they're going to be better than the guys. And I was like, what? No, it's not a war. We're not, do you know what I mean? We're not here to steal anyone else's thunder, kind of thing. And the way that was written was obviously to stoke these kind of hate comments of, no, all women are crap. And that resulted in 1,500 hate comments about me and my band and stuff. And it was after that I was just like, no, I'm not playing this game anymore. I'm not being the person that generates these comments. But it is quite sad, because there is like that Bloodstock show was the biggest crowd I've ever played to. It was like a huge achievement for me musically. And they uploaded a video of one of our songs from the set on their YouTube channel. And all the comments are about how fat I am and saying I look pregnant. And one person's like, oh, no, she's hot. And then loads of people have piled in beneath it saying, no, she's disgusting, vomit face emoji and stuff like this. And that was within the first day of the video getting uploaded. So I've had to stop myself. I'm like, right, okay, I can never watch that video now, because I'll read the comments and it will make me sad. But it just ends up being a shame, because I have to kind of detach myself from most representation of my band, like from videos that get uploaded of us or people that write about us. I can't read the articles or watch the videos, because I know there's going to be horrible comments about me. And I think that isolates me from my bandmates, because they don't experience it. Like, none of the guys in my band have had a comment about how they look, and they don't understand why then I'm there. Like, the whole tour I'm like crying, putting these like control corset things on under my clothes because I don't want to have more comments saying how fat I am, and they don't understand it. Like, it's quite isolating.
That's a horrible thing. And that's the thing, is like, there's so many ugly hearted little goblins out there who feel powerful because they're behind a computer, but 99% of them would never say anything like that to your face. And no one should be saying anything like that anyway, because it is a double standard. You're right.
Oh, no one, yeah. And yeah. I have three daughters, and that blows my mind that someone would, one, take time out of their day to be hurtful to somebody else. Like, it just, that makes me really sad, because essentially you're breaking boundaries and doing things that are so rad, and going up on stage and singing your heart out and playing your heart out, and people just have negativity. And fucking, that makes me so sad.
Yeah. it is a real shame. And I wish I could just go out on stage and play my guitar, which is what I'm there to do, and express myself and not have to worry about how I look. But it's just so, the pressure to look a certain way, or I'm always being compared to like hotter, skinnier women in metal, and then deemed to be not as good because I don't look like them. And it does just, it wears you down.
Yeah, well, your band is better, so fuck it. You know, on this subject, your song, The Currency of Beauty, from When I Die, Will I Get Better? I got the, you know, like the good music chills that you get when you hear a really good song.
Oh.
I love this song. And I think the lyrics are so powerful at the end. You say, stop fucking rating us. Stop fucking hating us. This isn't a pageant, and it isn't a compliment to receive such shallow judgment. And I think that's such a powerful message, because look at what you're dealing with. I mean, it's terrible what's going on.
Oh, thank you. Sorry, it's quite moving to hear. After what I've just said about all the things I've experienced, it's quite nice to hear, like, my own lyrics back. So thank you.
Of course. Yeah, I really like what you're doing. I really like the band. I've gone through that where I'm on social media arguing with people who don't line up with my belief system. And I don't do it anymore because I just don't care anymore. I find that, I mean, there's plenty of people out there whose belief system aligns with mine, but I just don't feel the need to go start fights with people anymore because, I don't know, it's just not in me anymore. I'd rather try to find the similarities in people than the differences, because I think at heart, most people mean well and they want to get along, unless you're just one of these really weird, racist weirdos that I don't want anything to do with. So I just try to find common ground in people. I don't know. Like if I feel like their beliefs don't align with mine, I just won't go there because I'm like, hey, I like this person. I don't want to dislike them. What do we agree on?
Yeah, exactly. I think it's the internet makes it a very easy environment to create intolerance and kind of exacerbate differences and create arguments based on political stances and beliefs. And sometimes it is good to take a sort of step back from that and kind of like you say, look for the similarities. And also I feel like having discussions online, having a discussion on Twitter, is people get upset so easily and take things so personally. The best thing to do is probably like talk to someone who in real life, if they say something you don't agree with, or if they say something that you think, oh, that's, you know, that's not on, just have like a calm conversation with them, because then they can hear the tone of your voice and you can have like a two-way discussion rather than this kind of very public, you know, shaming thing that tends to go on.
Yep.
That would be, I'm similar to you. I try to just sort of disengage from the social media comments wars, because I'm just not sure how productive it is or progressive it is, if you know what I mean. I feel like it can cause othering, which splits the divide even further.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not worth the fight, you know, especially when there's so many like ugly hearted weirdos out there who will say really horrible things to you because you're a woman. It's like, you don't need to expose yourself to that.
No, exactly. Yeah. My mental health is worth more than that.
Yeah. I have certain restrictions in place for social media. Like if, you know, I'm on Twitch all the time, sometimes I get too into it and I have to detox. Like certain things with Instagram and Twitter, like I won't look at. And I have like, I get too into it. So I have certain restrictions in place to make sure that I don't go too deep and that my mental health is preserved.
Yeah, that's absolutely the way to go. Like imposing a bit of control on those things and restricting certain topics is, you've got to protect yourself and you've got to protect your mental health at the end of the day, because it can be so damaging.
Exactly. Oh, so I read in another interview with you where you said you read all the reviews of your records and in some cases have even taken critiques into consideration, like maybe to change something up. Is that true?
Yeah. I really care about what people think. And I think a lot of people have great suggestions or like things that it's always really nice to hear from, because I think when you're creating, you're so buried in it and you're so immersed in it that, you know, you might be blind to a cool idea that just doesn't come at you because you're sort of so fixated on your own way of how you think things should sound. So like, I'm super open. I love hearing like feedback or like people saying what they'd like to hear more of, what they'd like to hear less of. Or, you know, I've noticed a lot of comments that say they really like that our most recent album has more of my clean singing on it. So I'm working really hard on trying to get my voice a bit better and a bit stronger so that I can do more of that live and put more of it on more records and stuff like that. Like, I don't think the band is just the sum of its parts, and I care about what anyone who listens to it has to say about it as well. Otherwise it's not going to evolve. Otherwise we'll just be Slayer releasing the album that sounds the same every 3 years.
I love that. Because usually when I talk to musicians, it's like, no, I don't read reviews. I don't want to be corrupted. I don't want to be taken down by the negativity. And you do the opposite.
Well, this is this thing. I mean, you say like, yeah, a lot of musicians saying about wanting to kind of preserve this, their own idea, but it's not this purity that people think it is. And if it is, then it shouldn't be able to be corrupted by fans or people who've listened to your band and who care about your band enough to write a review. Like, if they care enough about it to write 500 words on it, I want to hear what they've got to say, and I want to take that on board. It's mad to me to think that people kind of have this illusion of purity, that only they can kind of have the vision of what this should be, and they don't want it to be affected by anything else.
Yeah, because you used to actually write for a few metal magazines, right? So you're willing to take the writings into consideration a little more.
Yeah, I guess so. And I think like writing for metal magazines definitely helped me in a lot of ways when with doing Svalbard, because when I used to, I don't so much anymore. I write about gaming now, but like at the time when I'd interview bands, it really influenced my lyric writing, because I'd be interviewing these bands and I'd be like, right, what's the album about? What's this song about? And it was always super vague answers. It was always like really non-committal, really kind of like, oh, you know, this song's about politics, or this song's about feeling sad. And then they never went any deeper or any more specific. Mm-hmm. And it was being able to see that through interviewing bands that made me go, I want to go deeper with my lyrics. I want to be able to have things to talk about when I talk about my album. I want people to read these words and feel like they're reading someone's diary and feel like they can connect with someone through the words, because to me, the lyrics are just as important as the music. But that was something I learned through interviewing other bands and seeing what they had to say about their lyrics and their songs. It made me reflect on like what I have to say about Svalbard songs and try and hit a bit harder with the words.
I love that. That's kind of the same thing I'm doing with this podcast. And that's how I approach things too. I want to get to the core. I want to know the essence of myself and the people I'm talking to.
Absolutely. And that's great. Like, I love that we're having this super in-depth conversation and that you haven't shied away from any of the topics, because yeah, that's really good.
So you said you write for gaming. Wait, you write about gaming now? Where and what do you write about?
I write a games column for Kerrang! Magazine. And recently I've just been writing about Pokemon and the new Pokemon games that are coming out. And that's the main thing. It's just a column where I write about like new games, anything from like small indie games to the big, you know, AAA releases, that kind of thing. So yeah, it's fairly new. I've only just done the one column, so it's kind of getting off the ground now. But yeah, it's been really nice. It's been really fun to write about something that I don't normally write about, if you know what I mean.
Absolutely. So do you still game nowadays?
Yeah, I do. Unfortunately, at the moment, I don't have as much time as I used to because, yeah, as I said, I work a really stressful day job that I absolutely hate, which is kind of bumming me out at the moment. But yeah, where I can at the moment, I've been playing a game called Yoku's Island Express, which is like a Metroidvania sort of open world pinball platformer game. So the way you do the missions and get around the maps is by using like the flippers and like pinball kind of tricks to get through and unlock the next bit. It's really good. I'd really recommend that game.
That sounds good. Yeah, let's see, right now I'm into retro first person shooters, so Doom, Quake. There's some new Quake chapters that are out there. I play a lot of Call of Duty Warzone, and I'm always playing NES classics.
Oh, nice. Yes, of course. Which classics?
Oh, you know, all the big ones. Mario, the Mario series, Blaster Master, Kid Icarus, Mega Man, all that stuff.
Do you ever play Bubble Bobble?
I have not played that one yet.
Oh, you should play that. I love it so much. I have a tattoo of the characters. That's my favorite NES classic
really?
Game. Yes.
I'm going to have to try it. That's one that I did not play when I was younger.
And I want to come back to Doom as well. And just to say that the Doom soundtrack is one of the best soundtracks ever.
Right?
Yes, it's amazing.
It's so good. I sometimes just listen to it on YouTube randomly. And the best part about the Doom community is that there's people are always making new WADs and new levels and all this stuff. And I play a lot of them online. And sometimes I'll get so taken by a track, I like spend all this time on YouTube trying to find it.
Ah, I listen. It's amazing to hear because I listen to the Doom soundtrack on YouTube all the time. It's like one of my most listened to things.
Finally, somebody else who does it as well. Oh, that's great. So let's talk about what we've got coming up. Now, you said you had a tour that got postponed.
Oh, well, so we've got a tour with Cult of Luna and Alcest, which is amazing because they're like two of my favorite bands.
What a tour. Wow. Yeah.
I know. Like, I'm so excited. I'm just going to be like down the front with all the fans after we finish playing every night. That starts in February, and that's quite a long tour. I think it's 3 weeks in the mainland in Europe. And we get to play some countries I've not been to before, like Slovenia, which will be really exciting. Obviously, so it's, you know, I don't want to, because of everything that's happened in the last couple of years, there's still that voice in my head that's like, be prepared that it might not go ahead. So at the moment, just sort of like trying to sort of weigh up. Hopefully it will happen, but that is booked for February and March, so hopefully that will go ahead. And then we've got quite a few cool festival shows in the summer to look forward to. We're playing one on my birthday called Mystic Festival in Poland, and Mortis is playing, and I'm like super into Mortis, so I'm nice. Really excited for that one. And yeah, just loads of other cool festivals around Europe. So that's about it. And then in between all that, we're going to start writing our fourth album.
Now, you described your lyrical process as ripping your heart out and slapping it on the table. So is there more inspiration for the upcoming album?
Yeah, there is. I think the last couple of years have just been it's just been so heavy for everyone in so many ways. It's almost like there's too much, and I've got so many different topics because I try to have one topic per song and then thread it all together for like an overall vibe of the album. But I feel like with the new album that we're about to start writing, it's like, wow, where do you start? Like, do you start with the detrimental effect that the pandemic has had on mental health? Do you start with, you know, how it's developed even more sort of disassociation in people with the real world as they're kind of glued, everything's reliant more on a screen? Like, there's so much I want to write about on the fourth album. So at the moment, it's just like lots and lots of notebooks and thinning them down into things that can actually make a cohesive song.
That's good that there's no shortage of topics. I've been through that where the last album I put out, I was like, okay, I wrote about everything that happened. What would I write about now? But so much stuff has happened since then, there would just be no shortage of topics. I guess that's the way life goes.
Exactly. Like, if there's anything to be thankful for with the pandemic, it's at least there's even more, there's something new to write about.
Exactly. And you've got your solo project, Noctool. Now, I read, this was interesting. You said the next album is going to be about the afterlife in Skyrim.
Yeah. So I've started writing it already. The album's going to be themed to Sovngarde, which, if you haven't played the game, is the afterlife area where you go to in the game when you die. I remember when I first visited this area in the game, it like moved me to tears because the music is so beautiful and the sky is just the most, it's so gorgeous. Like, I could just exist in that world forever. It's so beautiful and dark and mysterious. And the music that plays when you're in Sovngarde is choral, which I have a real soft spot for, kind of those close choral harmonies. So I decided for the second album, I'm going to try and do like a choral black metal album. So I've written like the first track, and it's just lots of layers of clean singing over sort of hypnotic blast beats and riffs and stuff like that. And I'm really excited about it.
That sounds amazing. Do you find that are video games as emotional for you as they are for me? Because my history is tied up in games, and I listen, like I can watch a part from a game or listen to a certain soundtrack and instantly be moved to tears because it reminds me of being with my brothers and my family when we were younger. Like, do you find that as well?
Oh my God. So I went to see an orchestra play the Final Fantasy VII music live.
Oh, I would die.
Oh, yeah, I was a mess. And they had like a screen and it played all the like classic cutscenes and everything from the game as the music was playing. And when they did Aerith's theme, I was just crying. Like, but yeah, I get this all the time. So one of my favorite things to do is put on like the Kingdom Hearts 2 soundtrack and just cry to the Kingdom Hearts music, because it gives you that kind of overwhelming nostalgia for the days when you came home from school and you turned on your PS2 and that was your world. I just find I feel stuff so much more in a game and things, or just like the way they look, the worlds that they create. It really sort of, playing Final Fantasy VII is like coming home for me. So yeah, it's always, I find games incredibly emotionally moving.
Did you like the Final Fantasy VII remake?
I liked bits of it, but not overall. I would still prefer to just play the Final Fantasy classic as it is. I thought the remake, like some of the changes I didn't like so much, and the music I didn't like so much because it was too in your face, whereas like Final Fantasy normally is quite subtle and pretty. It just lacked that prettiness, I thought. But it was pretty cool. Like, I still played it and, you know, completed it and stuff. But yeah, it wasn't, I don't prefer it now.
Yeah, I like the original is like the Bible to me. I think it's the greatest game story ever told and that ever will be told. But the remake was like a new edition or something. You know, there's changes, but I'm like, it's good. I like it. I played it.
Yeah, I kind of feel like, to me, it didn't need to happen.
Yeah.
But I say that about everything.
All right, so let's recap. Now, folks, if you haven't checked out Svalbard yet, you absolutely need to do that today. Great band, great music, right?
Thank you.
Yes. And we're also going to check out Noctul. I mean, a band, music based on Skyrim. How could it be better than that? Come on, right? Check out Svalbard. They have plenty of live gigs coming up. So we can search out Svalbard online, Instagram, all that good stuff. Maybe pick up a record or some merch too, right? Right?
Yep. Yeah, yep. Best place is our Bandcamp for merch.
Yes.
Noctul, I should probably say Noctul, we are playing our first ever live show in May, which I'm super excited for. We are actually playing with Emperor.
Wow.
I know. What a first show. It's crazy. At a festival called Incineration Fest in London, 7th of May. And I'm super excited. It's going to be a show. There's going to be effects. There's going to be costumes.
Oh, my God.
It's going to be super fun. So I'm really excited to, like, have Noctul start doing more stuff in the live setting as well.
That's amazing. Excellent. Well, Serena, I want to thank you for taking the time to speak with us tonight. We love what you're doing. We love the music that you and the band are making. You know, for someone like yourself who's been through so much and has overcome everything, and you're turning it into beautiful art and you're doing everything you're doing, I think that's the greatest story of all. So I just want to say thank you so much for speaking to us tonight.
Oh, thank you. I've had such a great time. It's been absolutely lovely. So thank you. It's been my pleasure to talk to you guys, and thank you for having me on.
There you have it, folks. Serena Cherry. Excellent conversation. excellent band. She had a lot of great things to say. So many similarities, Tommy. She wrote a whole solo album about Skyrim. I mean, come on. It doesn't get any better than that.
The similarities between you and her are astounding.
We were talking afterwards. I don't remember if it made it on the show, but I was talking about how I sometimes go on YouTube to just listen to the Doom soundtrack, and she said she does the same thing. But yeah, that was a great conversation. The band is so good. It's in that similar vein to Respire, where it's like black metal influence, a lot more post-rock influence with Svalbard. Really dig the music. I really like everything that Serena had to say. Just overall great conversation.
I love the fact, and this is such a little part of this, but and it won't come up. I mean, it came up on the actual interview, but she loves roller coasters. She's a big roller coaster enthusiast. And I love the fact that she uses the internet as a way to find people with similar interests, whereas I use the internet as a way to isolate myself from other people.
You do?
Yeah, I mean, I use it to kind of, I keep people at a distance in that I don't have to, like, I can just say, happy birthday, emoji birthday cake, bye. And then I don't have to come to your birthday party.
Yeah, I'm the same way.
I think that's something I missed the boat on, is just the kind of RPG gaming that you guys really enjoy, like the, you know, Final Fantasy VII.
Yes.
And Scott, like that, I feel like I'm missing out on something, because a lot of the people that I'm very, very close with, like you and a couple people at work, are very into those types of games, like EverQuest. And I feel like I missed out on that. It was just never something I was into. But based on the people I hang out with and the people I spend a lot of time talking to and doing things with, I should have been involved in that.
I thought you played Dragon Warrior on NES. Wasn't that a thing with you?
I did, but it's that wasn't like the online thing where EverQuest and Warcraft and, well, you know, I guess Final Fantasy isn't online. But
yeah, you somehow bypassed all of that, Tommy.
Yeah, I just didn't.
You bypassed a lot. You're like a relic from a lost age. You're not like super online. You know, you're pretty grounded. You've got a family and a job. You're not sucked into this whole like crazy internet world of stuff.
Yeah, I think a lot of it comes down to I don't feel connected with a lot of those things. I think mainly because I don't get a lot of value from it. I think Instagram is neat to me to a certain extent, like watching people play guitar on Instagram or watching skateboarding clips, it's inspiring. But what it really makes me want to do is go play guitar or go skateboard. Like it's a catalyst for something physical in my life, rather than being a something that takes up a lot of time in my life.
That makes sense, and that's a good thing.
Do you do that? I've done this before, and I do it. I do it now, but I have the thing on my phone that caps the amount of time I can spend on social media every day.
Ew, I would never use that.
Do you get the screen time reports and then ever look at it and go, what the fuck am I doing?
No, because I don't want to know. I'm on social media from the minute I get up till the minute I go to sleep. Partially because I have to, but mostly because I want to.
So how many hours do you think a day? So like if you say
I don't even want to think about it.
Okay.
It's too much. I think if I saw that number, it would be too much for me.
Would it be enough for you to be like, I need to put this down?
Absolutely not.
There is no number that would be like, all right, that's excessive. I'm going to stop.
No, because I need to do it for the podcast, and I like to look at things and see what's going on. I need that. I want that.
Okay. That bypassed me for a number of different reasons, but I think when Instagram became extraordinarily popular or became kind of things that people were like, oh, I posted that on Instagram. I had twins that were probably like 2.5 or 3. Like, so what, when Instagram became like popular, like 5-6 years ago, right?
Like 2011.
Oh, never mind though. All right. So
Tommy, you're so wholesome.
Yeah.
You just don't know about these things.
I think that's why the pop culture minute works so well. It's because like I just don't fucking I just don't know. And I do get exposure to a lot of things from popular culture because of my students at school. But a lot of those things are specific to like Trenton or like specific to like, hey, there's this R&B artist or this rapper that does this. And it's like, it just doesn't resonate with me. So I'm like, oh, okay. And they're like, Mr. Doherty, do you know what the Renegade is? I'm like, no. They're like, it's a dance on TikTok. You got to do this. And I'm like, I'm not doing that. I'm just not doing that.
That's interesting. I was looking back through my Instagram somewhat recently, and I looked at my first pictures. They would have like no likes or one like. And I was like, wow, there used to be a time where I didn't even think about this stuff. I didn't think about followers or how many likes something got, or none of that was a consideration. I wonder when that changed.
My school posted a picture of me a few years back, and the guy who's the superintendent of all the schools came up to me and like punched me in the arm. And he was like, you're the most liked picture we have on Instagram. And I was like, excuse me? He was like, you must be really popular on Instagram. And I said, I don't think you understand. I think I have like 300 people that follow me on Instagram. He goes, well, every single last one of them must have gone on there and shared it and liked it because you got a bunch of likes. And I was like, I don't think you guys get very many likes then, because I went and looked at the post and I think it only had like 270 likes. And I was like, yeah, you guys need a different social media person. Like if 270 is your threshold for like a lot.
But did you feel good about it?
I don't think I felt anything.
You didn't care, honestly?
I think if...
Come on.
I'm trying to think back to that point. No, I think you know what made me feel happy was I felt good that my boss recognized me for doing something good. That made me feel good. I know
you
that.
You really didn't care about having the most likes at all?
No, I feel good that my boss recognized me and was like, hey, you're teacher of the month and you got a lot of likes. That was great for you. And I was like,
wow.
That
See,
made me-
we're very different because I'd be like, hey, I got the most likes. I'm the best.
I know I'm not the best, so I...
Well, I know I'm not the best, but I would just say it anyway.
I'm acutely aware of how I'm not the best, so...
So what's going on with us, Tommy? How are you? How is the new year treating you so far?
I'm doing really well. The girls are back in school. Everybody's healthy. Everybody's happy. The baby got potty trained over Christmas break.
That's done.
She is going to school now without a diaper on. The only time she is wearing a diaper is when she goes to bed at night. I couldn't be more pleased because that's literally one of the things I wanted for the new year was to stop changing diapers.
Exactly. And nobody's sick anymore, finally?
Nobody's sick. Everybody's actually in good health right now. We are all feeling great. Everything's going really well. How about yourself?
I'm good. I was really stressed. You know what? I was meant to talk about this on the show, but I didn't get a chance to do so until now. I burned myself out. I tried to get on like a 7-day work week thing with doing the podcast, working on the podcast every night. And then every night I wasn't working on the podcast, just being on Twitch, streaming something. And I burned out. And I got into this mindset where I thought I had to be doing something every minute. Like I'd be sitting there tired and I'd be like, you should be on Twitch right now playing a video game. You could be building that up. You should be working on the podcast. You could be editing. And I couldn't do it anymore. I couldn't do it anymore. So I took a step back. I didn't look at social media for a couple of days. I didn't look at Twitch for like a week. And so I just cut back when I need to. And I just stream when I want to now. And I don't worry about having to do it every spare second because I started dreading playing video games, Tommy, and that's the worst thing I could ever imagine.
Yeah, because that's the one thing that's one of the things that can give you happiness like immediately.
Yeah, and that's like how I unplug. That's how I have fun, and I turned it into this monster where I'm like, you have to perform, you have to stream. So I stopped, and I just take a step back when I need to. Sometimes I just want to lay in bed and eat a Chipwich and watch somebody play something on Twitch and not do anything. And I need to take those moments to relax when I need them. So that's what I do now.
Your ambition is wild, dude.
I know. It's unhealthy is what it is.
Do you really think so? But at least your brain told you to stop.
Here's the thing. I didn't let it get to a point where it destroyed me. I've learned my lesson in that department.
Well, that's solid. I mean, at least you have those kind of mechanisms to set you off of like, this is unhealthy. Let me take a step back. But yeah, that I wonder where that comes from.
It's just a addictive thing.
But ultimately, think about what you're trying to build to is some type of notoriety, whether it's through Twitch or the podcast or through a band. Is that, do you ever think about that or no?
No, you know, I don't think it's a notoriety thing. I think it's like everything we did with the podcast, right?
Yeah.
The building and the building up the Instagram and learning and all. It's like, I want to do that again, but on Twitch. You know what I'm saying?
You're an architect of creativity.
Exactly. Like I just, you know, I would like to do that again with a band. I would like to do that again with learning home recording. It's like, I want to take everything we've accomplished and replicate that in different areas, but I just don't have the capacity. I mean, we've got the podcast going on. I've got the band going on. I'm on Twitch sometimes when I have time to stream and when I feel like it. I can only do so much. There's only one of me, Tommy.
You know what, though? That's genuinely admirable because essentially what you want to do is you love the process.
Yes.
There's not many people out there that really like that type of stuff, Keith. Like a lot of people want the end result. They don't want the hard work that goes into making the end result.
Exactly. And just wanting the end result is so empty. And that's something I've learned in recent years, because to truly do something and succeed at it, I say this all the time now, you just have to love it. Like we went into this podcast not knowing a thing and having zero expectations and just doing it simply because we love talking about the music and to each other and our friends. And that's the way it's got to be. Like I go on Twitch when I want to play video games and I'm like feeling it. You know what I'm saying? And that's the way I'm going to approach everything from now on. I would never force myself to do something because I thought it was going to pay off or something like that. And, you know, I think that's just the way it goes naturally. Like, I've done a lot of things over the years. Stand-up comedy, I never liked that. I always hated it, and it was only good one time, I think. And that faded away, and there's different things that I did that just faded away. So it's like, the things that you're doing, the things that you keep consistently doing, those are the things you love.
Yeah, because you ultimately, you're choosing to go back to them.
Yes.
Yeah.
I can't do Twitch full time. Like, I would love to have an account with thousands of followers and get verified and all that stuff. But to do that, you have to be on Twitch full time. You have to play like every night. And I physically can't do that, nor do I want to do that.
So just to kind of bring me up to speed on Twitch, people that like, so like Arcus, right?
Yeah.
How many hours a day is he actually streaming? Let's just start with this. That's a daily thing too.
Yeah, except weekends.
Okay.
And even some weekends he does it.
So he essentially works a 9-to-5, but his 9-to-5 is live streaming him destroying games.
Exactly. By the way, there's some epic stuff going on right now. He had the world record for Ninja Gaiden.
Yeah.
And then this guy, the Retro Runner, got it recently. And Arcus is now training to win the Ninja Gaiden world record back. It's one of the most exciting things I've ever seen.
Can I bring up something that's completely unrelated, but something I've been kind of obsessing about in the last like 3 or 4 days? So I went down a little bit of a YouTube rabbit hole of fake guitarists.
Fake guitarists?
Yeah. So there is...
Wait, so you don't have any commentary on Arcus training to seize the Ninja Gaiden world record back? You don't care?
No.
No. I just think it's funny. I was so stoked. Like he signed on first day of the year and I saw him playing the game and I was like, oh my God, it would be like, I don't know. It would be like if someone cool joined your football team or something. I'm thinking of something like that.
Oh, like there was a new signing and you were like, oh, can't wait for this. Okay.
All right. This is like huge. To me, I guess. All right, what are you saying about fake guitarists now?
So I went on this rabbit hole of people going against, there's a lot of people on Instagram that are using either, different filters or shutter speeds or speeding up or slowing down the videos or recording them slow and then speeding them up to make them seem like they're better players, which people have no, it's seemingly what the real issue is that people don't have a problem with you doing things that kind of like make it look like you're a better player than you actually are. Because most of those guys that are doing it are actually very good players. What they are really upset about is that they are then trying to profit off it. Like, hey, you like the way I play? Cool. Buy my, you know, 20 lesson package for $150 or buy my sheet music or buy my tablature. And the one big one that they keep going after is, I don't know his name, but he's in a band called Buried Alive, B-E-R-R-I-E-D, Alive, like the word buried, like the fruit buried.
Yeah.
It's really funny because it's these people that are, you know, very popular YouTube guitar players, and you know, you can see them getting really upset because they're like, look, I come on here and I try my best to work to, you know, give good information and to do it in a way that is truthful. And I don't like to see other people profiting from essentially scamming people, saying like, hey, you can play like me. And it's like, nobody can play like you because you're fucking faking it. Like, so I went down a bit of a rabbit hole with that. There's a lot of videos about, if you just want to look it up, look up Buried Alive Fake. That's a big
one.
You
think that's more interesting than the Ninja Gaiden world record race?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, folks, different strokes for different folks. You know, that's why Tommy is Tommy and I am me. Listen, we cover it all here, from Ninja Gaiden world records to fake guitar playing and buried alive.
Yeah, buried. Yeah, B-E-R-R-I-E-D. Yeah.
Skip Buried Alive and listen to Buried Alive with Scott Vogel. You can't go wrong there. Now, folks, listen, we're out of time, but we're back next week with a new show. Thank you again, Serena, for speaking to us. Thanks, everybody, for listening. And until next time.